We're really happy and excited today to have with us the renowned Irish novelist, Mr. Colin Toynbee, to be here to give us a talk. Let me briefly introduce him to you, even though you all know about him. Mr. Toynbee is a native of Ireland. He has written 8 novels and he has been much awarded. The Blackwater Lightship has been shortlisted for the Booker Prize and the International Impact Dublin Literary Award. His autobiographical novel on Henry James the Master won the International Impact Dublin Literary Award. It was shortlisted for the Booker Prize. It was named by the Los Angeles Times as Novel of the Year. It was also further awarded by Stonewall Book Award, Lambda Literary Award, and also listed among the 10 most notable books of the year in the New York Times. His other novel called The Brooklyn, which was made into a movie, and we will be looking forward to this January in Taipei, has won the Costa Novel Award. The Testament of Mary was shortlisted for the Booker Prize, and Nora Webster won the Hawthorne Prize. Mr. Toynbee has been teaching at Stanford University, the University of Texas at Austin, Princeton University, and Manchester University. Right now he is teaching at Columbia University, and he is also right now the chairperson of the Penn World Voices. Okay, and I would like to represent the Department of Foreign Languages and Literature at National Taiwan University to welcome you today, and also my thanks to the Irish Studies Association Taiwan, which is co-hosting this event. Mr. Toynbee just arrived yesterday, so this is his first public appearance, so we are indeed very honored. So let us join together to welcome him this morning. Thank you. Would like to start with Q&A. So, since I am the moderator, let me ask the first question, because as people say, everybody hates to ask the first question. Mr. Toynbee, since I have told you in our emails that we have been reading Henry James in this class, this is a good part of this is my immersion literature class. And you are especially partial to Henry James. You have written a novel on him. And you also have a collection, All the Novelist Needs, which is a collection of critical essays on him. So would you speak more about him? And I'm especially curious, for a writer of the 21st century, why do you still go back to James? How has he influenced your writing?
I think that James, think about this. He realized that he could do something new with the novel in several ways. But let me just take one of those ways, which is that he realized there was something new happening in America, which is that American women, young women, were not like English women, especially the women that he knew who came from New England. You know, in other words, that they, instead of wanting to marry, were rank. You know, as in Jane Austen, where the idea that somebody had 10,000 a year means that you could marry them, and that marriage will then be successful because it will be a marriage which will involve rank, and that everybody is alert to how much money, for example, in Jane Austen's Pride and Prejudice, how much money everyone has. Mr. Bingley and Mr. Darcy are not merely men, but men with money. And the idea then is that while they have other qualities, and these qualities are qualities that Jane Austen begins to work with, that everybody is alert to the amount of money they have, as well as let's say, their moral qualities. James became alert to the idea that if you put into the novel a young woman who wanted something more from life than mere rank, that if she wanted marriage, it would be some sort of spiritual union, that she would seek something for herself, as in the deepest self, as in the self that can reinvent the self or reimagine the self, or the glittering self, That, in other words, the self, if you look at the self as it appears in Henry James's novel Portrait of a Lady, where Lord Warburton, who's an English lord, has sisters. The sisters are totally quiet, almost inert. They're almost not there in the book. But Isabel, the American young woman, is filled with life, filled with glitter. She shines. She has an extraordinary, she's on a quest. And the quest is not for a rich American, for a rich English husband. The quest is for something she cannot name that is almost spiritual. And James realized that if you put this into the novel, it would change things. So that thus, as he began his own quest to create a new sort of heroine in the novel, beginning, say, with a character such as Daisy Miller, moving on in Washington Square to a character such as Catherine Sloper in Washington Square, eventually with Portrait of a Lady, and then he will move further in the 20th century in those books he wrote, for example, in the character of Minnie Thiel in The Wings of the Dove. But if you just look at the character of Daisy Miller, that you're looking at someone who has arrived in Rome to disrupt the peace, that if she were a young woman, a young English woman, she would be advised, you know, that the only thing you need to do is seek a husband, and the only thing that you will get from marriage is rank. Because there's a sense in which, in her wildness, in her inability to obey the rules, she wants something else. She wants one more thing from life than obeying its rules, or one more thing from life than becoming a woman of rank and circumstance. That she wants, in a way, a fulfillment of the self in the future, in the way she will live. And that therefore, as a dynamic force, if we take the novel as a set of forces, almost like something you can see under a microscope, things darting and moving, sorts of energy, that the novel is made up of forms of energy. But Daisy Miller's energy represents a new sort of bright energy that has come into the novel from America. And her energy is essentially disruptive. What James will do in that novel is effectively destroy her. That when he starts to consider what will happen to such a figure with such an ambition in Europe, he will realize that Europe is not ready for this. That somehow or other the forces of, for example, good behavior, proper deportment, how to be seen, how to be heard, that these rules are very strict rules, that if you break them, effectively, you will die. And so that his first, in a way, his first use of this in Daisy Miller is a way, is a crude, almost primitive form of, you know, if somebody comes in to break the rules, this person will be punished accordingly. He will, as the 19th century goes on, he will refine this. So that he still speaks to any novelist working now, and I think to any reader, in the way in which he allows a new dynamic to come into the novel, where within what we might call the story of a young woman, the sort of governing spirit for that was Jane Austen, was the idea that if there is a young woman, she will be seeking a young man in marriage. And suddenly in James, he said, yes, she may be doing that, but she wants something else for herself. That there is, in the female characters that James makes, a sense of greater completion or of a greater number of desires that have been there in the novel up to then. And I suppose the best question to ask about character in a novel is, what are the character's desires? How disruptive are they to the general harmony? The more disruptive, almost, the better for the novel, because James said the great thing about novels. He said that the job of a novel was to dramatize, dramatize, dramatize. And in order to dramatize, 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 you need a conflict. And the conflict here is between a disruptive force, someone who almost has an animal force in the book that is at times uncontrolled in a world which is filled with regulation. And so those two things, the conflict between regulation and lack of control, continues to be something that you can use in a novel to this day. But that James was the, I think, the great 19th century novelist to show it. It happens in other novelists. It happens in George Eliot, especially in Daniel Deronda, where the figure of Gwendolyn in George Eliot's novel, Daniel Deronda, will be so filled with a glittering presence that you realize in some way or other she will be doomed. But before she's doomed, the story must be told of the trouble she will cause, the disruption she will cause to a community. And both Eliot and James were interested in this. And it was a sort of change, I think, that both of them noticed in the society, in the world around them, that if a young woman were to appear in the world in this way, that the world would take immense notice, that somehow or other a room would be enriched by the presence of such a figure. And so too a novel would then be vastly enriched by the presence of such a figure. And so James's first entry into European society was in Rome. And so he knew the city and how it worked very, very well. And he knew how the Americans ran their parties, how they ran their, how much gossip there was within this tiny enclosed community. Also, what I think the strangest part about the story is that later on in his life, certainly by the 1890s, James could stand in that graveyard where Daisy Miller is buried in Rome, in the Protestant graveyard, at a certain point, and he could see three friends of his actually buried there, three real people. That, in other words, William Wetmore Story, who was an important sculptor in Rome, whose parties James would have gone to, that was James's world in Rome. It was a world made up of American artists who were living in Rome. William Wetmore Story is buried there. Over here is John Addington Symonds, who was the first real writer, English writer, to write directly about homosexuality. And he lived in Italy all of his life. He was there. James wrote one particular short story about him and his family. And James wrote a book about William Wetmore Story and his work. But then right in front of him was the grave of Constance Fenimore Woolson, who was James's friend, who was American. And those women, Constance Fenimore Woolson, but especially James's first cousin, Minnie Temple, really do haunt his work. And I think nourish it and enrich it. In other words, Henry James had a first cousin called Minnie Temple. She was brilliant. Men loved her company. She was wild, she was glittering, she was curious. She had some sort of spiritual yearning. I mean, rather than looking for a husband who was rich or a husband who was respectable, she wanted something much richer and grander from life. And Henry James was fascinated by her. His brother William was fascinated by her. Their friends were fascinated by her. And of course, because Minnie Temple was an orphan, both of her parents were dead. James was also, and she was James's first cousin, he always envied the fact that, you know, she had no parents. Therefore, the rules governing Minnie were different than the rules governing other people. And so that eventually she died, and James was in Italy when she died. Her presence, I think she begins to haunt his fiction in various forms. He refines the forms as novels go on. But I think the figure of Daisy Miller is imagining
the arrival of his cousin, Minnie Temple, someone who doesn't obey the rules, and someone who is already doomed, who is going to die, I mean, she's dying of tuberculosis, so that is imagining, all you do is think of a young writer in Italy, hearing the news, sorry, I'm wrong, he's in England when he hears the news that his cousin has died, but he's traveling in Europe. But just imagine that he hears the news of his glory, of his wonderful cousin, and one of the things she wanted was to come to Italy. Even as she was dying, there are letters from her saying, I would love to be with you, I'd give anything to come to England and Italy, and to meet George Eliot. But Italy was one of the places she wanted to come. So after death, he could bring her to Italy. And he could imagine her coming into this very regulated community of the American community in Rome. He could imagine this young woman with such an extraordinary spirit and such disrespect for the rules arriving in this very stable society of expatriates in Italy. And so this ghost appears, and slowly he gives the ghost a sort of presence. He makes her, he makes what is shadow substance. And he does this in a number of novels. Daisy Miller, Portrait of a Lady, Wings of the Dove. I mean, he does this a number of times where he brings his cousin, who's dead, back to life in words.
Thank you very much for that. It was very inspiring, especially the part where you talk about the destructive desires, bringing such a heroine into the fiction, because it helps me figure out, I've always had problems with the ending of Daisy Miller, and from what you just said, I see that, because you know, at the end of Daisy Miller, it said that it's rumored that Winterbourne has returned to Geneva, he's still studying very hard, and I think from what you just said, it gives me an idea that maybe somehow, at least at this stage, James is still compiling to the convention and trying to return that story to order, some kind of order, but not in his later works.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. That this is the beginning of him trying to imagine this. And there is a letter to his brother where he talks about it being impossible to imagine Minnie Temple, their cousin, married. That the idea that her as a stable woman running a household for them was impossible to imagine. And so later on he will marry her in Portrait of a Lady. And the marriage will be a very dark and strange and destructive one, but it will be a marriage. She will have a husband, and you know, they will throw parties and they will know many people. And he doesn't kill Isabel Archer in Portrait of a Lady. And also in Washington Square, written just before Portrait of a Lady, he doesn't kill Catherine Sloper, that he merely gives her an old age where she's alone, where she has been almost punished for falling in love with an unsuitable young man, and now she's alone, becoming an old lady. But I think the first time he tried it was almost like a folk tale. And it's interesting always to try and reduce any work of fiction you're doing to a folk tale. I mean, by a folk tale, I mean it's something we can tell very simply, you could tell to a child in 10 sentences. You know, in other words, there was a young woman who came from America. She was wild, oh, wild, oh. You could sing it as a ballad. You know, she came to Rome and she met a young man. She was seen at night. Oh, she was wild, oh. And then one night, you know, when the wind was cold, oh, she died, oh. And then when the wind was cold, oh, she died, oh. And so at night, sometimes her voice can be heard, oh. When the wind is soft, we can hear her voice, the ghost of, you know, her will come, oh. You know, in other words, it's a very, very simple story that you can reduce almost to a folk tale, but you can also reduce it to a Puritan sermon. In other words, we have to remember that James, while his father was a free thinker, he comes out of New England, and he comes out of a tradition of where the highest form of literature almost are the great sermons. And the great essays being written by his father's friends, it was Emerson and Thoreau, all about how to live. And with the idea that if
this Puritan idea that if you should break the rules, if you should be seen at night in the very wrong place, then death, God will punish you with death. That is actually, he's enacting this in the novel, and that he will seek it away for the rest of his career to do something more refined with that initial idea of, I mean, see, his problem is really enormous. How can he end the story? Is there any other way he can end the story? Because he can't end it with the arrival of Mr. Darcy, say the arrival of someone with 10,000 a year, who is a match for her, and that they can sort of match each other, and that he will somehow tame her. Because there's a suggestion that her wildness is something that belongs so fundamentally to her. You know, he's not merely a side characteristic, that she is a disruptive force, and that the disruptive force cannot survive, not only in life, but in a novel. I mean, forget about life for a moment, but just what are the options you can do with her that even if in other books, when he has a disruptive force, he will send them back to America. There is a line in Portrait of a Lady where he's, I mean, Madame Merle, who's a disruptive sexual force also, someone says, where is Madame Merle? And Isabel says, well, she's gone to America. And Mrs. Touchett says, she must have done something very bad to go to America. But the option in this early version, I mean, he will do this time after time, of what to do with what he will call the new American woman or the young American girl who has new forms of desires and new ways to disrupt stability. You'll kill her. And but there isn't any other way to do it. If anyone asks a question, I'll give them my credit card for the next 24 hours.
Thank you for giving me such a chance.
I need a credit card.
Both the grand guy and the opportunity to ask any question. I'm wondering, how do you interpret the character Maggie in The Golden Bough? I mean, in the end, she is initially an innocent American girl like Jen's previous novels, but in the end, she tries very hard to protect her marriage, and she shows kind of courage characteristic of Americans, and she kind of learned some strategies to survive between these scheming Europeans. So do you think the end of the conclusion of The Golden Bough is kind of optimistic or pessimistic, and that means Maggie, such a these very vigorous characters, finally is domesticated like character, like female characters in English novels? Thank you.
That's a great question. And has anybody here read The Golden Bough? Am I getting silent? So can I take it that you haven't read The Golden Bough? Is that correct? Well, let me just tell you briefly, let me just give the plot away, really, of The Golden Bough. And it is that Maggie Verber, who's the daughter of an extremely rich American called Adam Verber, and they're father and daughter, there's no mother, there's no other children, there's just Adam Verber and his daughter Maggie. And they're wandering in Europe with plans to go back to America, but the plans are vague. Maggie decides to marry an Italian prince who has no money, who's called Amerigo. And she marries him. And the father then, what's he going to do? Because he's been with his daughter all his life. He meets Maggie's
friend, old friend Charlotte, who arrives, who's a sort of Daisy Miller figure, you know, who arrives, who's disruptive, and the father marries her. So now you have four characters, and outside them you have another woman called Fanny Assingham, who sort of comments on them all. Now it's wonderful. I mean, it couldn't be a better idea. You can just imagine the idea that if you and your father, and you met, you know, and certainly the two couples are always with each other. They're always having dinner. They're always having supper. There's almost no one else in the novel. You think, God Almighty, this is meant to be London. It's a big city. Where are the other people? No, no, there's just these four people in London and the other woman watching. And, of course, very slowly, the reader realizes, oh, my God, the prince, the Roman prince, and Charlotte, who's the marry the father, have been having an affair all along. But they have no money, they couldn't marry, and they decided one to marry the father, one to marry the daughter, and they're continuing their relationship. What would you do? I mean, what would you do? Think about it. So what's very interesting about the book then, it really is a sort of farce. I mean, you could make it into a very small short story and saying, well, Maggie just told her husband to stop. And her father and the other woman was disgraced. But James, at the very end of his career, becomes an almost religious novelist. I did a word search on the book called, there's a new system of word search called reading. And I did a word search by reading the book. But I think you can do a word search by just, you know, mechanically by putting in a word on a thing. And look at the word soul in the book, which is a word that James doesn't use very much. He tends to be interested in the body, James. He's interested in money. He's interested in the things of the world. He's interested in life. He tends not to be interested in a higher authority, like God. He's not a religious novelist, you know, in the sense that his characters are not religious. And there's no, even if Daisy Miller has an element of being like a sermon, or like a parable, or like a warning. In this novel, then, the daughter is fragile. She's fragile in many ways. She's not a powerful person. She's not socially powerful. She tends to be in the shadows. And once she discovers the enormity of what has occurred, the treachery, the sheer sexual treachery of what has occurred, that her best friend is having sex with her husband, and her best friend's also her mother-in-law. Just think about it. She decides, instead of creating havoc, to do something else, to see if there's a possibility for redemption. And there's a moment, there's an extraordinary moment in the book, in The Golden Bow, where the three figures, the father, the adulterous wife, the prince, and the other woman from outside who's always commenting, the four of them are playing bridge in a room, and Maggie's at the window watching. And James is always at his best when someone is watching somebody else. And as though it's a picture has been created, as though it's something visual rather than something in words. And she's watching through the window. And she starts to think about evil, not about treachery, not about adultery, but evil. She sees evil in the room. And then later, as she watches her mother-in-law, who's also her husband's mistress, she starts to think about a soul, the phrase used is a soul shrieking in pain. And this is a very unusual phrase for James. He doesn't tend to use religious imagery or religious metaphors. So that the extraordinary thing about the book is then that this woman, this, you know, who's she's someone's daughter, she's someone's husband, begins to grow in moral stature as she attempts to rescue this situation. As she attempts, first of all, to separate the two lovers, to bring the two marriages back together, to get her husband back
to give her father back his wife, to separate them. Something very grand morally occurs in her growth as a person in the book, in her growth as a spiritual entity in the book. And so in the second half of the book, someone who has been shadowy becomes substance, and becomes high moral substance. And so the pattern of the book then is almost the pattern of, it almost has a religious pattern, in that someone has been given grace who had little grace, and that grace is almost divine grace, and her ability is to create moral goodness out of something that is spectacularly treacherous, but James will use the phrase actually evil. And so the book therefore has to move very, very slowly, very carefully, in long sentences, with a great deal of qualification and modification, because it cannot be a sudden conversion. It's not as though she suddenly became this powerful woman. It's that she slowly, by moving them, by watching them, by thinking about them, she begins to have power over her father, her husband, and her father's wife. She begins to exert an extraordinary moral influence in the book. A book that seemed at the beginning not to need moral influence, because it was as though they had so much money, they didn't need moral influence. But it was as though the money corrupted them. So when it's back again with the idea of the Puritan impulse, that money, it was the that, you know, they married for the money, and the money did the corruption. In other words, the wealth of the father brought in the evil. The evil came towards the money. And I mean, it's like something from a Puritan sermon, except, of course, that James was using the form as a novel, which means that the change, the influence, the way in which Maggie functions has to be imperceptible, slow, social, done at dinners, done at social events where she's slowly exerting an influence. She's slowly growing in the way that she can come into a room and dominate the room in a way that the others cannot defeat her. And it is as though there's a battle going on between the devil and God in the book, but that James has brought it to the level of a human and has made this woman into some sort of angelic or anti-demonic or even sacred figure who can defeat evil slowly and carefully by using social graces without ever using religious terms herself. This is Maggie. She ends up having an influence on the other three, which is almost religious. So that you move in a way, I mean, I think the movement from Daisy Miller to the Golden Bough is the movement also of a novelist into areas of nuance and subtlety and deep care with narrative procedures. So that while the, let's say that the dynamic force released in the Roman story is quite easy morally. You know, woman behaves badly, woman is punished. I mean, it just goes up and then down. Whereas in the Golden Bough, it's constant waves of slow change, imperceptible additions, and it's, you can almost see the full trajectory of a novelist from between one and the other. It's over a period of what? Over a period of 40 years, he fundamentally changes himself as a novelist. And I think it's his most subtle, and in a way, his most difficult novel. But anyway, that's so that at the end of that book, you feel that, that what she has achieved, Maggie Berber, is a sort of moral grandeur. and that moral grandeur has been achieved very convincingly within the confines of the novel form. In other words, he didn't go into using sermons, he didn't go into parables, he didn't have to use a particular religious trajectory for her, he used a social trajectory. But nonetheless, at the root of it, at the heart of it, or in its shadows, is some set of religious impulses that have caused the novel to have the sort of power and subtlety that it does. Portrait of the Artist is that you can literally watch the style of the book moving from the like baby talk at the beginning to the fragments at the end. And it is, I suppose, in a way that's more obvious than the Golden Bowl about the growth of a soul as much as the growth of a figure in society. That in other words, the portrait of the artist as a young man, that isn't as though you are seeing him acquiring wealth or acquiring confidence or acquiring possessions or being able to you know somehow or other move easier in society. It is as though by the end of the book he's almost deeply unsettled by his own mind. That in other words, you're talking about the idea of the intellect itself as a disturbing force in a novel, that's by arguing, thinking, having to deal with concepts in the book. I mean, the concepts again are sometimes religious, are philosophical, and that Stephen actually has deeply unsettled himself, and you're watching formally. I mean, what's interesting about the book as well is just how long that sermon about... I mean, when I was reading it recently, I thought, I didn't remember this sermon about fire being so long and in such detail, taking up so much space in the book. I remember there was a sermon, but when you look at the book, it is actually an enough... I mean, if you were talking about the book as a painting, that business of hellfire and of the effect of its imagery has on this very sensitive soul, that in other words, because it comes to him in language, that it is constantly in the book about a growth of language, about a way in which language is put under pressure, nourished and allowed to grow. I mean, from the baby talk at the beginning to the fragmentary entries, diary entries at the end, it is the story of language itself being used in certain ways. For example, the language of the sermon, the language of hellfire, religious language, the language of philosophical argument. And so that it is a novel in a way that deals with its own literary form, much more than, I mean, as much as it does with character. In other words, it equates the growth of Stephen with the changes in him from a boy to a young man. It equates those changes with changes in literary style or changes that are open to further change by language, by different types of discourse. So the more you study the tone and texture of the sentences, and the more you study the actual sentence structure of the book, the more you get about Stephen's actual growth. And so it's a fascinating book in that sense, that it is a novel about language, but it's also a novel about literary form, in that the opening will try and mimic the way a baby talks, and the end will have a sort of set of diary entries and fragments which are very close to what we might see in painting in cubism, or in the breaking down of melody in music. That in other words, the arrival of what we might call fragmentary, the use of fragment in modernism, the fact that nothing stable in narrative can be there now under these pressures, which you find in T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland, in Ezra Pound's Cantos, the idea of quotations, of breaking off, of references to earlier work, that all of that comes by the end of the portrait. And so you're actually seeing Joyce's own effort to realize that realism, in other words, the idea, the old idea of the possibility of holding a mirror up to a society or to a person, and that the novel would actually be like a mirror, whereas this idea that will come again in Joyce's Ulysses, of the essence of narrative being to crack the mirror, you break the mirror, you leave the fragments on the ground, and you attempt to connect them, but realizing that that attempt will always be futile. So that's it.
Thank you, Mr. Tobin. It's so nice to have you here. You write about immigration in some of your novels, and immigration seems to be a common concern among contemporary writers. We know contemporary writers such as Monica Ali, Honey Qureshi, or even Rushdie, they all write about issues of immigration. How do you think of your writing on immigration? How do you distinguish yourself from them? And on the other hand, Berkeley mentioned about contemporary writers, how do you situate yourself among your peers? Do you situate yourself as an Irish writer, British writer, American writer, or international writer? How do you say about this? Thank you.
I mean, I think that the emigration has been the secret history of Ireland since the 1840s. That every family, every generation lost somebody. But obviously it wasn't something that many people wrote novels about, because of course, if you arrived in America, you know, your first aim was to find a job, and that took you so long to settle down. By that time, the chances of becoming a novelist were sort of zero. But we do have fragments, for example, the Irish novelist George Moore, who was a contemporary of W.B. Yeats. You know, his dates are something like 1850 to 1930. George Moore wrote a famous story called Homesickness, about a man going to America, and in America he's homesick, and then he comes back to Ireland, and in Ireland he's homesick, so he goes back to America. In the 1950s, the Irish writer Brian McMahon, and he wrote a story about a man who goes to England, and he's away for 2 years, I think. And he comes home, and of course there's no telephone, and he can't write, and he's illiterate. He doesn't warn that he's coming. So he arrives into his house, he sees his wife and all his children. He's been away 2 years, very surprised to see a brand new baby there as well. Wondering how that brand new baby arrived. And that's a story, that's another. So that in the Irish tradition you get these stories. There's a story by Benedict Kiley where people come back from America, Irish people, and they build a house on a hill. No one in Ireland builds a house on a hill because of the wind and the rain. I mean, they just say, oh, they're just people back from America. You know, in other words, that they're being in America they have forgotten something so fundamental as to where to build a house in the Irish landscape. They think you can build a house on a hill and everyone local is laughing at them. So that was there before this generation, such as Salman Rushdie, Hanif Qureshi, Monica Ali, in the United Kingdom. I suppose I'm concerned about the idea of globalization and the novel, and about the idea of novelists feeling somehow that this label will help the novel. I see those writers very much as being having an argument with the empire, with the whole idea of that it's almost the empire strikes back. In other words, that it is that argument that starts in the tempest between where Caliban says, you have taught me language, and now look what I can do. Now look what I can do with the words that you brought to me via colonization. I will reform your novel, the form for you. I will get the form of your novel. I will play with it. I mean, and I see this as being a Joycean impulse, that arising from a country that is within the empire, but feels somehow or other grander in some way than the empire. I will get your novel form and I will wring its neck for it. I will put an end to your novel, to your nice novels of manners, adultery, inheriting money, chance, choice, destiny. I will get all of that and I will destroy it for you. And I see that Joycean impulse, being an impulse that you can still see happening. With London now not no longer an English city, but a sort of really strange and odd world city that can nourish a novelist by just the amount of noise being made in London by different people from different origins. I have no place in this. I was brought up in a really stable country. We got independence in 1922. My father was a member of the main political party. We held power for all those years. I was brought up, there was a hatred of England in the background, but it wasn't very important. What was much more important was that my father really was a member of the party that ran the country. And he used to say about the other party that you could salute them if you met them. It would be bad manners not to salute them. But if you voted for them, your right hand would wither off. And so that's sort of factional. I mean, it was a very stable place. Everybody knew their position, the bishop, the prime minister, And I think that the books I write have a sort of formal stability that almost arise from that. I wish I didn't have to connect the way I write sentences to some larger thing, because it'd be lovely to feel that writing sentences or forming a novel is an act of pure will. But that doesn't seem to be the case. So I suppose the answer to your question is I'm Irish. I'm Irish.
Yes, just to follow up on that Joycean impulse, as I remember that there was an early review calling Joyce's Ulysses as a Trojan horse sending into disrupted English language, so that might be the case. But just to back a little bit, as an Irish, as you mentioned, so just very basically, what does Joyce or reading Joyce do to you as an Irish person and as a novelist?
Joyce comes in many guises. Essentially, he comes in four guises, and perhaps even five if you think about his life. But that the style he describes in a letter, he describes the style of his book Dubliners as being a style of scrupulous meanness. that there are no flourishes in the book, that adjectives are sparely used in the book, that these broken figures in this sort of broken city are described with immense care and austerity. I think this has had enormous influence on style. This is as revolutionary in its way as Hemingway, especially if you look at the work being created all around it, that this simplicity that carries with it enormous coiled emotion, and that he, by the end of The Dead, realizes that he doesn't want to, that he wants almost to repudiate, when he comes to the end of the book Dubliners, he wishes to repudiate the very style in which the whole book is written by finding a style that is, or finding a number of paragraphs which are filled with the 1890s, with the gorgeousness of English prose, with easy repetitions, with bringing in a sort of poetic terms, with a sort of totalizing impulse as to move above the characters, above the landscape, and actually allow the language to sing, or at least have enormous or sonorous qualities, which he has denied the language up to then. So that you can see the tensions in Dubliners and in Portrait of the Artist, that the whole idea of the male self in dispute with Catholicism and nationalism, and the way in which he will give that male sense, that male figure such autonomy and power in the book, and the power to repudiate once more, but also the power to remain alone, that somehow or other that idea that there will be no society, that there will merely be consciousness, and that out of consciousness something can come. Obviously, each time you feel he brings himself to a dead end. In other words, at the end of Dubliners, he writes as though this will no longer, that to write a book such as Dubliners will for him be no longer possible because of those last paragraphs. He has sort of stopped himself doing it again. By the end of Portrait of the Artist, once more in these fragmentary diary entries, he has said, you know, there is no place to go beyond this. But in the second book, in Portrait of the Artist, he has very much insisted also that that even if the novel he's writing is based on things, French novels such as, say, Sentimental Education, or those novels which a young man, who's an intellectual, uses his intelligence to effectively destroy his sensibility, that will happen in a way outside society. I mean, the wider world won't matter in that book. And then he repudiates, in a way, by coming to the fragmentary end of that book, show that cannot be continued. That the male self, given such an amount of intense scrutiny outside society, cannot hold in a further novel. It isn't as though you could write a second part of that book where you would show the Portrait of the Artist as a middle-aged man. There would almost be no one. He is almost as though he has allowed the character he created to disappear in the very book he was making. And out of that then comes Ulysses, which really is, first of all, I mean, there are many, many ways to read it. But let me just read it this way, very briefly. This is being written between 1916 and 1922. These are the very years when it's clear that Ireland will become an independent country. They're also written in years when it's pretty clear that the sort of independence that Ireland will get will be dominated by the Catholic Church. That it's not as though Ireland wishes in its nationalism, in its anti-imperialism, to create some new set of forms whereby society can be made. It would almost go backwards into nationalism rather than into, say, cosmopolitanism. it will go become insular rather than open. And Joyce is watching this from one of the great places, I mean, the great places of the world, which is Trieste, which is filled with different voices. There are about 5 languages being spoken. This is the main port of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. It's the second city after Milano, of where any cultural activity that happens in Milan will also happen in Trieste. It's filled with, it has a large Jewish population, it has a German-speaking population, it has a Slovenian-speaking population, it has an Italian-speaking population, and it has a dialect-speaking population, and it has many people coming and going. So that this idea of the myriad, of the city as a place that stands against the nation, in which many people, the nation is referred to in Ulysses as being the same people in the same place. But actually, in the way that Ulysses is dealt with, it is the idea that many different people are living in the same place, with many different desires and needs. But the one that Joyce, two things that really matter here is that Leopold Bloom is Jewish. He's not Catholic. So in other words, by making a Jewish hero, by making him a sort of everyman, by making him a modern man, in other words, he sells advertising. His interest in nationalism is very limited. So he's almost involved in having an argument with the society that's coming into being. And if you see this politically, it's Joyce actually offering Ireland an image of what it might be by allowing its hero or its self-image to be Jewish. And the second thing, of course, is the allowing in of sexual desire. The constant, all day. You know, in other words, the fact that so much sexual desire, Leopold Bloom's desire, which moves in waves in the book, but what he's doing really is he's thinking about sex almost all day. Now, he often thinks about other things, then it goes back to thinking about sex. And of course, his wife is having an affair with another man, and the pain of sex, the pain of desire, and then ending, of course, with the one thing that will not exist in the new state that's going to come into being, is a woman's voice. The one thing will be silenced will be the sexual woman in this new state that is about to come into being. So that, I mean, one of the impulses behind the creation of Ulysses, you know, as in later on, when we were talking about those other novels that I think take their bearings from Ulysses, written in England by, let's call them English writers with a hyphen somewhere in their identity, will attempt to have an argument with a conservative image of the nation, of what being English means. Salman Rushdie would have an argument with the whole idea of the English language, of, you know, who owns the English language, who owns England, who owns history, will be his argument. And there will be others joined in an argument. And my argument will be that's essentially a Joycean argument, in that part of the impulse behind Ulysses was also, of course, to take one of the great European stories and hand it to Ireland, to give it to an ordinary Irish day, to connect Ireland not to its ancient warriors, its ancient stories, which are being invoked day in, day out in these years. You have no idea in these years that every play being put on is a retelling of an ancient Irish myth, to say, I'm going to get you an even better story, a Greek story. Give it to you as though you can possess it. So that the attempt then to suggest that versus insularity, I'm proposing a sort of sensuous cosmopolitanism, is a political act, and that the impulse behind it was effectively political. He was involved in an argument with his own country, which in a way is what Stephen is doing in the portrait, in a way which is almost private, hermetic, sealed, and futile, in Ulysses is opened out into becoming something much more powerful, because of course Bloom moves in the city. The novel is filled with the city's voices, and so that is one way of reading the book. And you know, then the problem he has, of course, is what to do next. And I mean, it's not as though you can write a sequel to Ulysses and say, well, what do they all do the next day? I mean, that would be preposterous if you were to say, what do these characters do a year later? This, you know, in other words, that he has made a novel in which the characters are so locked into the novel itself, the idea that, you know, in other words, that the form he has created almost comes first. The characters then move in and out, circulate within that structure. But the idea that they could emerge again a year later and we could find out what happened with Blazes Boylan, or did Stephen eventually emigrate, or, you know, what happened to, you know, various, what happened to all those people, the citizen, you know, would be preposterous. Because, of course, the book so much depends on its tone, on its own sort of formal procedures. But so that the only place to go is into the whole idea of language itself, the word, as a set of words, as a set of jokes, as a set of echoes of other words. And, of course, this arises again from living in Trieste, where you're hearing so many sounds, and that as you walk every street, the sounds come from the original idea of sound. So that Finnegan's Wake attempts to marry some idea of myth to some idea of sound. And again, once that's done, it's sort of like Daisy Miller. Once that's done, you have to kill the author. And he died very young. It was a medical mistake. If the doctor had diagnosed him properly, he would not have died. But nonetheless, it would have been hard. It's hard to imagine what you would do after Finnegan's Wake. So it's very difficult to talk about Joyce as a single entity, but as a set of developments which were absolutely astonishing, and which continue to puzzle us, and continue to mean that every time we discuss him, we're really only talking about one aspect, and we can talk about many other ones. So I hope that's some way of saying I cannot answer your question.
Study issue in Daisy Miller, because when I read this, I think that the study here mostly it's about Winter, how Winterbourne look at Daisy, but for Winterbourne, it's for me he's like a Europeanized American, like the Europeanized part is his tradition, that he takes a European form, courtesy, and also a repression, like the American Puritans. That reveals the innocence should be like pure and no sexual experience or spiritual innocence, that you shouldn't have or limited contact with the male. However, Winterbourne, she also views that the American is the best. But American in the early American literature is like the virgin. It's separate. It wants to separate from the European and. He views himself as a virgin. And in the Leaves of Grass, they have the original urge that I think it's similar to Daisy. And I think the Winterbourne's dilemma on how to study the real American is quite interesting, since Daisy herself, as a real American, she tries to study the males or study Winterbourne by interacting with him. And Winterbourne is like the observer who's observe the Daisy's behavior. So I'm thinking that these two ways of study, what's their merits and what's their downfalls, and what can we learn from, or what can we adapt from these two ways of studies in our today's study, no matter in literature or no matter in our cultural encounter with different nations.
I mean, I think the problem that James had, there's a famous essay, there's a famous passage in a book he wrote in 1879 about Nathaniel Hawthorne. You probably know this passage where he's really trying to describe the dilemma that a novelist has who comes from New England. The sort of thinness in the society, which I think is something that an Irish novelist would also be aware of, and that is another way you can read Joyce, that since there was no deep-rooted middle class in Ireland or in New England, that the novelist then had to improvise. And the improvisations then become a great sort of nourishing force in the modern novel, in modern literature. But it begins with lack. It begins with things that are not there. So that if you look at the heroic period of the novel, the novel is at its most heroic and confident and sure when it's rooted in societies which have built up a manufacturing class where people for three generations have possessions, where wills, testaments, money passed on, all of those things can really matter in a novel. And where, for example, I'm talking about the novel in England from, say, Jane Austen through to, George Eliot, where you're watching the society reforming itself in the background. And in the foreground, you're watching an individual in peacetime being able to confront her or his destiny with ease and a sort of grandeur. But you can't do this in Ireland. In Ireland, if you tried that, someone would burn your house down. I mean, that's what we did to anybody who thought they were comfortable in Ireland. We burned their houses. So that, I mean, if you have a house in Ireland where there's a party going on and a young woman is thinking of marrying a young man, well, there's a fire. You know, somebody will just set fire to that house. And so, in a way, the literature arises from the conflagration. James, in that essay, in that book on Hawthorne, talks about the number of things that are not available to the novelist of New England. And he talks about these, he lists them, and I mean, just like there's no parliament, there's no sporting class, there are no ivy ruins, there's no, and he just lists, if you just check it, if you just go online and Google Hawthorne book list, and he lists the things that are not available. And so, but this is complicated in James, because he realizes that the fate of being an American, and he uses the phrase himself, that it's a complex fate, which he would see the fate of being English as being a simple fate. And so, once more, we're back with the argument that people like Salman Rushdie or James Joyce will have with the English novel, or with English life, that there is a simplicity in it, that one almost feels deep contempt for, coming from societies which have greater complexity by dint of just not having the same sort of deep roots that almost every generation can invent itself, and that there is an immense possibility of violence and destruction, or indeed improvisation everywhere. So that James brings his characters to Europe almost because he has no sense of what they would do in Boston. In Boston, the Jameses were so grand. I mean, his grandfather was the second richest man in New York State. His father was a great talker. His father's friends were Thoreau and Emerson and a few other men of that sort. In Boston, he would have known the Nortons, the people who ran Harvard. It was a very, very small society, described pretty well by Louis Menand in that book, The Metaphysical Club. I mean, a group of intellectuals who were operating almost in a place that was distant from the center, attempting to create a sort of American way of believing and thinking, and which at the center of the essay would be an essay like self-reliance, or that whole idea that each person has a duty to make themselves rather than to fit in to an inherited set of values. And James's problem is that you cannot set a novel in such thin soil. It just simply cannot be done. If you think of the distance between James's Boston and the city of London, and London not only filled
with different villages, with the rich and the poor on top of each other, but filled with the sense of what Dickens did, what Thackeray, what so many novelists had done before, what indeed Shakespeare had done before, that you had this density going on in the city of London, and indeed in Italy, the sense of an old world that was there constantly. I mean, it's there in the background of Daisy Miller, the idea of Rome itself as a city, as an eternal city, as an ancient place. And the problem James had then was that his characters are mainly American. And I mean, if you think that, if you look at Portrait of a Lady, all of the characters in Portrait of a Lady are actually Americans. It's not as though he's writing about some old Europe, because he didn't know that either. He had no concept of, for example, what was happening in Paris in 1872 or 1848. He wasn't interested in reform or revolution in Europe. He saw Europe, quite wrongly, in fact, as being the stable place with 1,000 years of slow growth and stable manners, whereas Europe is in itself a set of disruptions from the French Revolution, from, for example, even the Reform Acts in England of 1832, 1864, which gave more and more people the right to vote in England, which George Eliot understood in England, that England is a place of reform, England is a place of constant change. James saw England as a place of stability. So that he's always has a problem as a novelist, which will in one way maim him as a novelist, and another way nourish him, which is that he cannot see his characters in any wider context than they themselves could imagine in a single room when they're alone. So that it isn't as though Daisy is involved in Roman society. She's not involved in Roman society. She's involved with a few Americans who are, you know, happen to be in exile in Rome. So James is the great novelist of exile. And it's not as though Daisy has wandered in to an old set of morals and manners, whose rules she's breaking. She's wandering into a set of very brittle rules made by people who have recently arrived themselves. This, of course, means that James can get a much more, let's say, intense drama from her dilemma, because it's not as though she is consorting with other young Italian women of her age. There almost isn't anyone else of her age that she can consort with. And therefore she can be noticed more. And this whole idea in James, the central thing is always the glance, the glimpse, the sudden look of recognition, where something is known by seeing. And that idea will remain central. For example, rather than information being commonly known, information will be suddenly understood. So that Daisy is being watched. So what you're talking about, who's watching who, watching who, watching who, becomes a theme for so many James novels. I mean, at the moment in Portrait of a Lady, when Isabel understands her dilemma, it's not when she hears something, it's when she walks into a room and sees her husband, and he's sitting down, and Madame Merle is standing up. And in the pose between them, the woman standing comfortably at ease at the mantelpiece, and the man sort of sitting. Something strange about that. That's enough for her. That's enough for her to know. And later on, in Portrait of a Lady, when she goes to see Pansy in the convent, they don't, herself and Madame Merle don't have to speak. They know by looking at one another what one of them knows, what the other one knows. That idea of knowing and looking becomes central in James. And as though somehow there is such an amount of thinness in the world. There are so few people in his novels. It's not as though his novels are teeming with life, that somehow or other these people will become so refined that they can recognize in a face something that has occurred without having to be told. The novel becomes filled with the drama of looking, the drama of recognizing, the drama of glimpsing, the drama of glancing. and that all that will become central to his system as a novelist, which is actually quite unique. You know, in other words, it's hard to think of another novelist who that idea of glimpsing and glancing works. But it arises, I think, from that initial feeling that he did not come from a society rich enough in its textures to create a proper novel, and that he saw Hawthorne, for example, as an example to him of what not to do, except, of course, to go to Rome, which Hawthorne had also done. But James was not particularly interested in writing a later version of The Scarlet Letter, of becoming a sort of figure, or even becoming someone who could celebrate the American soul, as in Whitman. But both of those things were oddly anathema to him, partly because of his rich reading of the French novels. So he attempted to graft what he'd been reading, what Zola had been doing, what Flaubert had been doing, onto a set of characters who were absolutely isolated in Europe. And by isolating them, he almost found a purity in his fictional procedures that he might not have got had he been from a sort of richer place. I don't know if that answers your question, but I think we have to keep watching in James for who's watching who, and knowing and not knowing, secrecy, a secret known, being suddenly understood, and that being central to his fictional method.
Could I ask a question? Hi, I teach drama here. I teach drama in this department, and the next play I'm teaching is Oscar Wilde, the Lady Windermere's fan, and I'm sure you know about the ending of the play. It's by the end at the end of the play, the mother of the putative good woman in the play, having saved her daughter from ruin, decides to return to the continental Europe and taking her secret with her, because she's a woman with a past, a fallen woman with a past. And that ending reminds me actually of your recent novel, Brooklyn, which has already been made into a successful movie recently. Congratulations on the fact. And my question is, I see this reversal somehow, you know, from this 100 years ago, we have the plays of Oscar Wilde, and we have the novels of Henry James and Edith Wharton, dealing with Europe as this old world, as this sort of depository of dark secrets, or as this place where, from the perspective of the Puritans, where more corruption is permitted or even encouraged or tolerated. But of course, we come a long way from that century. And could I assume, well, to think that you no longer in your novel see a Europe from that kind of perspective, but in a way, in a way, you no longer even see America as from the perspective of the Age of Innocence, in a way, and instead it's kind of taken over the role that Europe used to play. It's as a sort of a depository of secrets of where moral indiscretions are allowed by you know, have this Irish heroine going through all of this.
I'm trying to answer that in two ways. The first one is that we have to remember one of the strange things about, I think, that the novelists, male novelists who write
novels about women don't like to admit. And I will deny this. I know this is being recorded, but I will deny that I ever said this. I'll say I didn't. It got someone vaguely looks like me up here. But that these figures from Wilde's women, James's women, to perhaps even my character in Brooklyn, are self-portraits, are secret versions of ourselves. So that Daisy Miller, there's another way of reading Daisy Miller, which is a gay man's account of being in Rome, which is, if I am seen in the night in somewhere I should not be, behaving inappropriately, I will be punished accordingly. This is a letter to myself saying, stay home in the evening, because if you go out, you'll be in some park or some dark place, you'll be seen. And that'll be the end of you. And so too, if we look at recent productions of The Importance of Being Earnest, it's now so common. I didn't know this, but there's a great new thing in the world called students, and they often do much better work than I do on something. I had a student who did a paper on recent productions of The Importance of Being Earnest, where Lady Bracknell is played by an actor rather than an actress. Now, they really are huge in number. It seems you cannot do this play anymore in the normal way where Lady Bracknell is a woman. And if you do, that's old-fashioned. The modern thing to do is to get a big actor and to have him come on the stage as Lady Bracknell, as a version of Wilde, and you have to be careful when you use the word version of Wilde. I mean, it's not as simple as that. And you have to say, as some sort of way, that the way the imagination works is, he begins to give Lady Bracknell his best lines. He begins to enjoy her most. She, of course, is the only one in the play, is that right, who is not going to get married. Everyone else is ready, even that old Chasuble is ready to get married to Miss Prism. And so everyone else is in the marriage state, you know, is ready for this, except Lady Bracknell, who's the author and, of course, the homosexual. And so that those images of secrecy, of a quick departure, of, of sudden death, all arise, I think, from the fact that both Wilde and James were gay, and that they were attempting to find in their fiction ways of dealing with this without having to write about it directly. Or they were attempting in a way to prevent themselves writing about it directly, but it seeped through, it just found its way into the work. That's just one thing, it's quite difficult to deal with this, because if you deal with it too directly and crudely, you cannot just say, oh, Lady Bracknell was gay. Wilde was a gay man, Lady Bracknell is a Wilde in drag. It's never as simple as that. I mean, you have to allow artistry. He created her rather than letting her create him. But, and so too with James, who is, I think, even more an artist, who is better at finding metaphors, finding pretty good ones far away from himself to deal with his own particular dilemmas as a gay man in Rome. I mean, just imagine being gay American in Rome with everyone watching you. Well, of course you can't write about that directly, but it's pressing on you deeply. I mean, when night falls in Rome and you're walking home, what are you going to do? And so slowly the figure of Daisy Miller emerges, someone who does break the rules. The second thing is that in writing Brooklyn, I had to really work out what her dilemma is. And when she's in America. And her dilemma is simple. She cannot read Tony. She does not know who he is, because his charm for her, if it were Irish charm, is untrustworthy. You cannot trust a charming Irish person. Irish charm is always a mask for great dark feelings, So you want to get them drunk, then you see they're really, really, really old. Or ask their family what they're like. Say, you know, that charming boy, once he comes in his own house, is really insulting to his mother, or is really horrible at home. The minute he goes out the door, he starts smiling. In Ireland, a smiler, you watch a smiler very carefully. There's something wrong with a smiler. It involves neurosis of some sort. When she goes to America, she meets a smiler. He just smiles. He's always telling her, I want to tell you the truth. Hey, this is who I am. She presumes there has to be another part of him, the dark, the strange, the damaged. And slowly she realizes there isn't. There is just this. This is who he is, which in Ireland could never be possible. In Ireland, no one would ever show their true selves from moment one right through. So you're dealing once more with the transatlantic dilemma, which is the how to read people who are not from your country. And the power this can still have in a novel. And I suppose I took this from James, just the idea, but I just brought it in the other direction, where even though James's characters, say, unfortunately, are all Americans, they're all Americans in Europe. They have learned a great numbers of European tricks of about secrecy, about withholding. And Isabel comes with all her glittering innocence to deal with this. So even though they're Americans, they are Americans who have been refined by Europe and in a way destroyed morally by Europe. I wanted to send her the other way, but the problem remains the same, in that I can dramatize the distance between two ways of reading character, two ways of writing character. And so that the Irish guy that she sees is all withholding, not saying much, sort of melancholy. It takes a long time to get to know him. Tony, the minute she sees him, is exactly who he says he is. But she can't believe that. And so you can still play with those old things. I mean, I wonder when it will end. Perhaps it will end when we start writing novels where people come to Asia and we try and read you guys. And I think that'll be much harder or more dramatic.
Okay, thank you.
There are two
My question concerns, it's a more general question, what is the future of realism today? In a culture that's already saturated with visual realities and with all this kind of digital technology, it seems like, for example, adaptations of literary novels, like we have Fitzgerald's The Great Gatsby. I mean, so much is lost in that translation. And like what context
to
replace literary realism today?
I have a problem with a few things that you've said, just the terms you're using. I wonder if I know our culture is meant to be saturated with visual imagery. My problem is I just don't see it. I can get through a whole day where I think maybe some odd things I see are interesting. But I'm not saturated. I'm just not involved with that. I live in a literary culture. I live in the 19th century, and that's allowed still. You know, in other words, that I don't. If I need some piece of information, I'll go to Google. I don't like the telephone, so email is much easier. But I'm not saturated by that. I mean, I just go do that in a normal way. But I do know what you, I do think I know what you mean about it, except that it hasn't happened to me, and it hasn't happened to many novelists. When it does happen to a novelist, when a novelist starts to think, I am saturated by visual imagery, you get a really bad novel, saturated by different forms of sort of, let's say, you know, glittering styles opposing each other as though you're looking at a set of neon lights flashing at each other. And it looks to me like a Dobbs dinner. But that's perhaps a matter of taste. second thing is, I'm not sure what realism is. I mean, I know that we have definitions of it that George Lukács and various European literary critics looked at. I found the Great Gatsby poetic. And I found the sentences have great amounts of resonance in them that strike me as poetic, meaning that they seem to reach out beyond their own information to some grander sense of rhythm that lifts them from what they tell you into some other realm. Now, this seems to be something that happens particularly in say, Fitzgerald. It happens also in Hemingway, where the actual sentence, if you take it out of its context and look at it closely, seems to have depend as much on its sound or on something between the words that suggests a great deal than its mere act as a thing that tells you who, where, when, as a piece of information. However, I find that there is a novel written, I would put Graham Greene in this context, or other English novelists. And I suppose it does come from not being, I mean, the best, Samuel Beckett was asked, you know, are you English? And he said, au contraire. But I do find the English novel, or many English novels, absolutely anathema to me, in that I find the sentences are merely telling you what they need to tell you, and that I'm getting nothing more than that. And I suppose that's realism. And the other thing is, I suppose, that the novel itself is such a hybrid form. I mean, it really does come out of so many other forms, such as the confession, such as, you know, the autobiography, such as the essay, such as the parable, that it can survive any number of onslaughts, including, I think, you know, onslaughts from the visual, but even onslaughts from times when it itself seems exhausted. In other words, it is possible that somebody could write a pure realist novel. In other words, sentences that are clipped and sharp and informative, that move on, that tell you what they need to tell you and nothing more, that don't have resonance, that don't have a sort of poetic edge to them or a glamour to them, and that novel would somehow or other matter enormously or seem to enrich the form, that the novel can keep renewing itself. It's really hard to kill the bloody thing. And that may be one of the reasons why films of novels tend to disappoint, or not just disappoint, but make the form, the visual form known as film, seem pathetic, seem cheap, seem lousy, seem quasi ready to let you down, seem so rich with cheap efforts to make money for itself that you just sit there watching it, wondering when will it end. Whereas the novel form can actually continue to work in various forms and systems with a sort of purity and a sort of naturalness, as though it belongs to us somehow or other. As though, now, I have a friend who, everything I says, he always says, but isn't that called capitalism? And I always say, oh my God, I suppose it's called late capitalism. You know, in other words, I always lose the argument. It always ends up, yeah, it's probably capitalism. But that's not a very interesting thing to say about it. There are many other more interesting things you can say about the way in which, from the late 18th century, once the individual thrusting, you know, capitalist can emerge, somebody who has not inherited money can actually make money, self-invention, thus the characters can self-invent it. You know, like you can really connect the novel, the rise of the novel, to the rise of a certain class, a certain confidence, a certain way in which money is moving in a different way. And you can say, money continues to move, not only in the ways we keep reading about, like, you know, you can make a million in a year, but you can actually, even slower way, I mean, money seems to have survived. I mean, we still have money. I mean, despite all the technology, I could still hand you a $5, what, do they have $5 bills? A $10 bill, you know, in money, in actual cash, which, you know, it seems as though the novel has the same propensity to survive as actual money, not billions, not trillions, but actually, look, if you could give me $30, I could buy some lunch and get home. Like the third, you know, that the novel still lives in the same way as small amounts of money still live. But I have trouble with the term realism. And even the way I've tried to define it to you, I don't think it's very good. And I've also trouble with the word saturated by visual imagery, because I just don't feel I am. But I'm sure if I went to a good psychiatrist or a good anthropologist or Jean Baudrillard or someone, they would tell me, you are, you just don't know you are. That's what's wrong with you. So you're probably right. And I'm just, you know, I'm just being contrary on a, you know, on a good morning. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I have a question about your novel, The Testament of Mary. Okay. What motivates you to write this novel? I mean, through the detached cold eye of the protagonist Mary, as it seems to me a intuitively protective mother. There seems to be a sense of challenge or mockery of towards Christianity in general. But Christianity, the power of which relies so much on the Gospels. So I'm interested to know what are your major concerns when you wrote this novel. Thank you.
This novel, The Testament of Mary, is a short novel in which Mary, the mother of Jesus, actually speaks. She's an old woman, and she's been guarded and protected, perhaps, by two figures, and they have left her alone for a time. And the illusion is created that she is speaking in real time, and that the novel is short enough that you can read it in one sitting, in the same way as she, perhaps in one evening of her life, for once say what it is that happened. There are a number of things. One is I was paying a lot of attention at the time, and I'm back working again with this, with those Greek heroines that really do continue to, I think, move us so deeply and matter so much to us. Medea, Electra, Antigone. The idea of powerlessness coming by courtesy of voice into power. So the power of a voice having a texture, the textured tongue, the voice of someone who has no power can emerge almost theatrically as full power. So I imagined it almost as a piece of theatre, and it has been a piece of theatre, and it has been performed. And it was performed in theatre before it was published. The second thing is that the novel form itself is a secular space. It does not lend itself to miracles. Now, so this is, people wonder, why did no one ever write this before? You know, because it's such a great story. You can tell the story of the crucifixion from Mary's point of view. Well, because novelists would not know what to do with the miracles. Did Jesus or not heal somebody? If he did, this really won't work in a novel. Novels don't like healing. A good doctor is a good thing in a novel. Medicine is good in a novel, but not God coming down and giving you an arm and you didn't have an arm. You know, novelists don't like that. I mean, Zola, Flaubert, there's no novelist really too good at this. Even in the novels of, say, Garcia Marquez, where, you know, there's a constant sense that he's playing God, but not that God is God. So, therefore, I had to be really careful with the miracles. And I brought the novel down to the human. Now, once you do that, you're breaking glass.
especially if you're dealing, if you're coming out of my childhood, which is an Irish Catholic childhood, constant praying to Mary, not to God, not to Jesus, but to Mary. Mary was our queen, you know, and so there's an element of mischief in doing it, which, I mean, I was talking earlier, I think mischief is one of the great governing impulses in the creation of any sort of fiction. I think putting the Jew as your hero in a Dublin, in an Irish novel written in the beginning of the 20th century is a piece of mischief. And therefore the novel Ulysses really does start, and the number of blasphemous jokes in Ulysses, constant blasphemous jokes in Ulysses. But I take exception to the word mockery, because I made her very serious. I made her tone very serious. I tried to make you believe this is what somebody like her might have thought, what she might have done, how she might have responded. But I'm not laughing at her. I mean, it may be that the wider implications of the book are to suggest that this son was a bloody nuisance. His friends were, you know, malcontents, stammerers, you know, ridiculous, and his sermons was all a form of self-aggrandizement, and she didn't believe a word of it. But that's a wider implication in the book. But I'm trying to stop you thinking it's mockery by making her so serious, by giving her such a staccato tone, by giving her sentences that are so sharp, observations that are so filled with dark force, that I'm trying to stop you even thinking that. Now, I know you must think it once you put the book down, but I want you to stop it while you're reading the book. You don't promote this is some all-Irish author who's just been bitter about his religion, trying to break some windows in some churches in Ireland. Is there nothing better for him to do? I want you instead to say, what's she going to say next? What does she see next? What does she do next? I just want to try and create an illusion for the time you're reading the book that this actually happened, that she did speak like this. So I take exception to your use of mockery, but I do know what you mean.
I'm sorry to have to bring this to an end, but we should overtax you. Thank you so much for taking such a big sort of question today. Our department has a souvenir that we'd like to present to you.
It's going to be.
Chinese characters, mysterious writings, and also from the Irish Studies Association, they would like to present you with the poster we made for you today.
I sort of say that that I found this scarf, and what's the name of the poet? One Wind Sing, did I say that right?
Yes.
And that he only writes 35 characters a day. So I'm bringing this back to Ireland to show everybody. This is a Taiwanese poet, and he writes 35 characters a day. And if all of us in our lives could do that, just write 35 characters a day. But also, it's got his erasures. Look, he crosses some words out, and then. So I think this is for any writer, this is a great thing to have. 35 characters a day. Okay, that's my rule from now on. So thank you very much, and thank you very much for your questions, and thanks for coming.